everybody, it's 503, I know, but I tried connecting twice and apparently I wasn't audible. And so give me a heads up if you can hear me. Everybody, give me a heads up. Babu, you need to move this because my hair is really acting funny. Okay, people are joining me really fast now. So I am audible to you, right? Everybody, I'm audible to you. Babu, am I audible? Okay, superb. So I am audible and I'm going to continue our day 11 of the hashtag 21 day lockdown challenge that I started 11 days ago when our Honorable Prime Minister Modi ji announced a 21 day nationwide lockdown. And so I'm going to keep the remaining part of this conversation towards the end because it's already 5:03 and I had already told the doctor that I will see him at 5 p.m. on my live. So today we have a very special guest. As our 11th guest on this hashtag 21 day lockdown challenge, who is Dr. Lancelot Pinto. He's a respirologist, and for many days now after my live and over my messages and stories, I've been asking y'all to send me questions if y'all have any regarding COVID-19. So today doctor will give us scientific insights and probably share the statistics that he's authorized to share regarding this pandemic. एंड बहुत लोगों के मन में बहुत सारे डाउट्स होते हैं और जैसे जैसे हम इस बीमारी में तेज़ी से घुसते जा रहे हैं इस प्रॉब्लम में हमें ये भी पता चल रहा है कि बहुत सारे क्वेश्चंस, बहुत सारे सुपरस्टिशंस, बहुत सारे रूमर्स भी पैदा हो रहे हैं. तो टुडे वी विल ऑल्सो ट्राई टू बस्ट सम मिथ्स विद डॉक्टर लैंसलॉट पिंटो. नाउ आई वुड लाइक टू क्विकली इंट्रोड्यूस हिम बिफोर आई जॉइन हिम ऑन दिस लाइव. सो डॉक्टर लैंसलॉट पिंटो इज़ अ कंसल्टेंट रेस्पिरोलॉजिस्ट एट द PD हिंदुजा हॉस्पिटल एंड मेडिकल रिसर्च सेंटर माहिम मुंबई एंड द हिंदुजा हेल्थ केयर सर्जिकल हॉस्पिटल खार मुंबई. And he was a gold medal recipient at the DNB examinations in respiratory diseases, and he was trained at the McGill University, Montreal, Canada, during which he completed a master's degree in epidemiology and clinical fellowships in sleep medicine and COPD rehabilitation. He has a keen interest in research and has over 60 peer-reviewed publications and is a peer reviewer for a number of leading journals in the field. He has also collaborated with the University of Cape Town, consulted for the World Health Organization and USAID, and continues to collaborate with McGill University. His main areas of interest include management of severe COPD, drug-resistant TB, smoking cessation therapy, and the management of sleep disorders. Now, the list is really long, and also, obviously, I am not a doctor or I don't belong to the medical field. So I don't even know how to pronounce a lot of things, but yes, I do understand a little bit because I was a science student until the 12th. And so having said that, today I'm also going to be taking some questions which Dr. Lancelot will answer. So doctor, if you could send me a hi, then it'll be easy for me to join you and to look for you. And I want to tell you guys that till doctor tells me a hi, I want to tell you who is a respirologist, क्योंकि ये भी जानना हमारे लिए बहुत ज़रूरी होता है. कभी कभी हम इतने सारे experts में confused हो जाते हैं. तो respirologists को pulmonologist भी बोलते हैं. जैसे डॉक्टर इंदु खोसला थी जब आई थी, वो pediatric pulmonologist थी. And तो respirologist को pulmonologist भी बोलते हैं, जो doctors होते हैं जो specialize करते हैं treatments of respiratory disorders में, यानी कि lung diseases, asthma, pneumonia, breathing problems, all these things. So therefore COVID-19 एक ऐसा pandemic है जो हमारे respiratory tract को infect करता है. And so I will let the doctor talk about it. And yes, I can see Dr. Lancelot. I'm going to try and connect him now. Good evening, Dr. Lancelot. How are you?
I'm good, Nisha. How are you?
I'm good, thank you. I'm so happy to have you on board, and I really want to thank you with all my heart for taking out your precious time and joining us on this live today to just create awareness and let people know about this whole pandemic.
No, thank you for inviting me, and you're doing a great job with this 21-day challenge. I think it's really important for people to get knowledge, to get information, to be engaged in some way while we're all locked in at home.
Yes, thank you, doctor. I hope you and your family, everyone in your team is safe.
Yes, so far so good. Thank you.
Okay, great. I hope and pray that it continues to be so. So, doctor, we're gonna, like, we are in day 11 of this whole, you know, lockdown, and obviously this whole pandemic has began in 2019, and therefore it's called COVID-19, and it's a part of the family of the coronavirus. So could you please tell us that there is so much awareness already from authenticated, you know, places like the World Health Organization? Our Prime Minister keeps coming online and talking about it. So I would like you to start with whatever you feel that is extremely important in this area of the pandemic for people to know at this moment, because now we are in day 11 and probably 3 months old globally, you know, into this pandemic. So what are the kind of problems that are arising, or what is it that you think is the need of the hour that you really want to share with people?
So like you rightly say, I think a lot of us have a lot of information now. We're bombarded with information left, right and center on our WhatsApp groups, on email, on all possible sources of information. I think the question that I'm getting asked a lot right now is, you know, what's next? What's the future? What exactly is going to happen after day 14? Or where are we headed? And I think the most important things that we need to remember, irrespective of whether it's day 14 or maybe day 200 down the road, is that the rules remain the same in terms of basic hand washing. I think that's one thing that's universally known is protecting individuals from the virus. Frequent hand washing is what's going to really protect you. Social distancing, I think, is here to stay. So even if the lockdown may be clamped, you know, the clamp may come off, maybe we're back to something resembling normal life. But I don't think we're really going to be able to sit next to somebody and watch a movie for some time. Or I don't think we should be doing it for some time. Social distancing is the second thing that's here to stay. And I think a powerful tool that is emerging in this fight against this epidemic is the use of masks. And it's a great thing that, you know, it seems to have picked on to a great extent when I walk on the street, even whether it's the fruit vendor, whether it's the watchman of my building, whether it's people around, I think it's picked up to a great extent. And I think that's going to make a huge difference. So I think these three rules will remain constant: social distancing, washing your hands and wearing a mask. I think no matter what happens, until and unless we are super confident in terms of getting a vaccine or having some drugs which are known to be safe and effective, I think till that point of time, these three rules are going to remain constant.
Okay, great. So I wanted to know that now that you spoke about wearing masks, you know, what is the importance of wearing the mask correctly and not reusing disposable masks, because that itself could act otherwise, you know? So could you please, I'm not really expecting you to, like, you know, do a demo right now, because I understand the constraints and we were not ready for something like that. But if you could just, you know, talk about disposable and reusable masks and the importance of it, it would be great.
So I think the most common mistake that people do when it comes to wearing masks is you intermittently take it below the nose and leave it there. I think most of the information that we're getting on the virus in terms of studies done so far is showing that there is a significant shedding of the virus from the nose. So unlike other viruses where, you know, the pharynx seems to be the major source, the throat seems to be the major source of virus. In this case, even before a person gets symptoms, even before a person gets fever or a sore throat or a cough, the shedding begins from the nose. So if you wear a mask and you're going to just cover your mouth, intermittently bring it down, that's not good enough. You know, you have to make sure that your nose and the mouth are both covered. The next question which I get asked often is, you know, should I be wearing an N95 mask? Will a simple surgical mask do? What about a cloth mask? What about a disposable mask? So an N95 mask is designed with the intention of preventing a person being very close to the patient. Okay. Or doing procedures or doing things that are likely to generate a ton of aerosols. So, you know, for example, when we tube a person, when we put in a tube, when we're about to put somebody in a ventilator, the person coughs a lot. There's a generation of a ton of aerosols. That's when your probability of getting infected is very high. And that's when a doctor needs to wear an N95 mask. Okay. For most regular interactions, you know, which day-to-day interactions where you're not likely to be in prolonged contact with a person at a close distance, a simple mask, something like this, which, you know, which most of us have, should absolutely be good enough. The question is, okay, these are meant to be disposable. These are meant to be used once and then discarded. And yes, that's absolutely the ideal way to do it. Not just from a perspective of whether the mask would be effective or not, but if you take it off and you have it lying around and say you are infected, then that becomes a source of infection. Somebody else touches it, it's just lying on the surface. It can generate what we call aerosols. That can spread. If in principle, if there was a way to use a mask but keep it absolutely locked in and secure and then reuse it, maybe that's not so bad. But unfortunately, that doesn't seem to be a very practical situation.
Right. Right.
So in an ideal world, you would want to use a mask only once. A
right.
simple face mask is good enough as long as you cover both your nose and your mouth. You don't. Most people on a regular basis will not need an N95 mask. It's also more difficult to wear an N95 mask because you need a seal. It's almost, you know, when you suck in, you should feel a vacuum. And that's difficult for most people to use on a day-to-day
right.
basis.
Right. And if we don't need it, I mean, it's better they don't take it, because then there's already a dearth of a lot of these things, and let it be available for the people who really need it, right?
The N95s, absolutely. Absolutely.
Yes. Yes. Great, doctor. And, you know, that actually reminds me that this morning I was watching ABP News, and I saw this segment where they were trying to bust some myths. So there was basically a doctor, and they were randomly talking to different people on the road, you know, about what are the kind of rumors making rounds on WhatsApp. And then they were asking a doctor to clarify that. And it struck me that I'm going to be talking to you this evening. So I also made a note of some of the questions that I thought may be relevant. So,
sure.
I'm going to ask you some of those. So now that we spoke about aerosol release through the nose and all of that, I'm going to ask you something related to the nose. So apparently, they said in the news that Ayurveda says something like put mustard oil in your nose so that it lines your nose with the oil, and it prevents the coronavirus from entering your nose. So could you please bust that myth or say something about it?
So again, I will not diss Ayurveda, or I will not say that it's it's you know, pseudoscience or whatever.
Right.
But the way I work is, the way we work in allopathy is to recommend something, you would need to have a strong base of evidence. There need to be some sort of a study where you've shown that, you know, you take half of the group, give them this mustard oil, take another half of the group, don't give them this mustard oil, prove that the group which receives mustard oil is going to get better. And then you would recommend it. So to recommend it without that kind of proof is number one, risky. Number
right.
two, as a chest physician, as a lung doctor, we have seen patients occasionally develop pneumonias because of sniffing oil. So when you sniff oil, oil droplets can actually enter your lungs, and they cause something, called a lipoid pneumonia, which is a pneumonia caused by irritation. It's chemical irritation of the oil in the lung that can cause a pneumonia.
Right.
So I'm not totally sure that the use of oil in any form in the respiratory tract is really safe.
Yeah, and I also believe that okay. For a moment, even if I buy the fact that, you know, it does line your nose, what about your mouth or what about your eyes? I mean, how does it prevent
True.
The coronavirus from entering through those ways? You know, great.
True.
So another myth that I heard of was that if I put a lot of cream, then the coronavirus is going to stick to my skin. To which the doctor said, you might as well wear like clothes, like, you know, full sleeves or stuff like that. So what do you have to say about that? I hope you're not really finding this silly, or if it is, then people should not listen to rumors like that.
No, I mean, nothing is silly. I mean, as long as somebody believes in it, you know, it's worthwhile discussing it.
Sure.
And, you know, at the end of the day, what you believe is what you believe. And if it's if there is evidence to suggest that it's not true, there's nothing silly about holding on to those beliefs till they're dispelled.
Right.
So I mean, to the best of my knowledge, I don't think the use of any cream is going to alter your susceptibility, make you more prone or less prone to picking up the virus. You know, that's pretty much what I know about creams.
Okay, great. So now we're going to come to some questions, because after every live, every day, you know, on your suggestion also, I kind of reached out to people and I told them that if you have any questions, then please let me know. So there is a girl who sent me a question. She's a handicapped girl, and she wants to know that if you're a handicapped, are you at more risk to the infection in some way? I know it's a very like a huge broad spectrum, you know, if you talk about it, but yes, please.
So I mean, if you're talking about a physical handicap in terms of being unable to walk or unable to perform some activities, I don't think you're at an increased risk. If you have a handicap in the way that your lung function is affected, for example, you know,
okay.
some people have curvatures of the spine, for example, that can reduce their lung function, then you may not be more likely to get the infection. But if you do get the infection, you possibly will have a more severe version of it, simply because the reserves of your lungs may not be adequate. So I would be very careful if I had structural lung diseases of any kind, you know, whether it's a spinal deformity, rib cage deformity, lung problems. You would want to be a little more careful in that situation.
Okay, doctor. And is it possible that we talk in a mix of Hindi and English both.
Absolutely, absolutely.
A lot of people request me, and I just it keeps slipping my mind every
bilkul,
time.
Bilkul, bilkul, koi problem nahi.
Okay, great. So, what about the statistics? If you're allowed or authorized to share any, in terms of how many people contract this virus out of sheer ignorance, because they're probably just not following these basic hygiene methods that you just suggested in the beginning of our conversation, you know, because of sheer ignorance. I mean, is there a statistics like that so that people are more aware and they can take care of these things?
So there are events which are called super spreader events, which we've seen in the past.
Sorry.
In China, there are okay. events which are called super spreader events. So where, you know, okay. where there's a congregation of a lot of people. And it has been seen in the past that, you know, about 2 weeks after such events, there is a spike in the number of cases. So in China, it was the Chinese New Year. So just before the Chinese New Year in the city of Wuhan, there was a huge gathering of people and there were celebrations and there are a lot of social dynamics to those kinds of celebrations where I think people feed each other, etc., as part of the culture. And, right. You know, a huge spike in the number of cases has been attributed to that gathering. In Italy, there was a football match which has been was attended by a lot of people from across Europe, and that gathering was a brewing ground for the virus moving around as well. So in terms of ignorance, yes, you know, so if just based on this evidence that when people have gathered in huge hordes and have not gone ahead with the kind of recommendations of social distancing, wearing masks, etc., it does seem that puts you at a greater risk of getting the virus.
Okay. And there is somebody who sent a question which asks, will the body develop an immunity to the virus after having it once?
So that's a question which the whole world is asking right now. That's a very good question. And unfortunately, we don't. I don't think we really know the answer to that question yet. It does seem that you have antibodies. So that's being demonstrated very soon in India as well. We will have a kit which will tell us whether we have antibodies or not. The presence of antibodies would suggest that you had infection in the past. But whether these antibodies will protect you from the next infection is difficult to say. Which is why, for example, in a disease like the flu, we recommend annual vaccination. So you have a vaccine every year because the immunity that lasts from one vaccine, one suspects that it's about a year. And, you know, then after that, you are again prone to getting the virus. So we might see the same pattern with corona, with COVID-19 as well, that you get sick, you recover. But there is always a possibility that you may get reinfected in the future.
Sure. And also because it's such a novel virus and, you know, we're so new into it, I believe the research is still on and we don't really have answers to a lot of questions, because to answer a question like that, somebody needs to get it and there needs to be a separate team dedicated to researching only this point, whether you've developed antibodies. And I believe right now everybody's hands are full and the healthcare workers are more into curing or into the whole preventative zone than rather this.
Okay. Right. And as you rightly said, you know, we have about 2 months of experience of people who have recovered. The virus has been around since 3 months, but assuming that it takes about a month for a person to recover, we have just about 2 months of experience with people who recover, and, you know, we'll see if they get reinfected in the future.
Right. Also, a big question, because a lot of people have recovered from coronavirus. So does that, because people are mixing up vaccines with cure. So I want to know that, is there a cure for coronavirus?
So when you say cure, you would mean a person then is immune to it happening again?
No, I'm not saying immunity. I'm saying that, is there a cure? Like, for example, I contract COVID-19, so will I be cured? Because there are reports that people have been cured out of it. So there is medication in which you can get cured, right?
No, unfortunately, there is, as of today, there is no real medication that's universally recommended or we have supreme confidence in. There are drugs which are currently going through clinical trials. There are small studies initially which have shown some promise. We are recommending hydroxychloroquine for individuals who are infected right now. But, you know, whether that's going to make a huge difference or not, time will tell. We don't have the large studies that we normally base our recommendations on.
So what are the doctors working on in terms of curing the patients? It's more like the symptoms, they're relieving them of the symptoms and gradually patients come out of it, or do they, will they always carry the virus in them when they say that people have cured? What does it mean?
No, so the body has its own immunity that will develop over time.
Okay.
So when you get any viral infection, be it the common cold, be it influenza, be it parainfluenza, you know, there are a whole bunch of viruses that affect human beings. And the normal way in which viruses work is you get a viral infection, you have a period in which you are sick, you're unwell, but gradually the body recovers with its own immunity. Whether that immunity confirms resistance for life is something that is virus specific, and that's not true. But right. even if you look at COVID-19 and you look at individuals who are young, say in the age group of 30 or so,
right.
I mean, most individuals have a short period in which they are sick, but most individuals recover completely and go back to a normal life after that.
Okay, great. So Dr. Nozair Sheriar is who I spoke with on day two regarding pregnancy during COVID-19, because it came to me because a friend of mine has just entered her pregnancy, and you know, there is a lot, because there's couples who've just conceived, who are just about to deliver, who's probably entered the second phase. There's a lot of paranoia amongst couples like that. So he shared a very, very interesting point where he said that it doesn't get transmitted from a mother to an unborn because it's a sterile environment inside your body. And the amniotic fluid and breast milk are basically sterile. So I took his interview on the second day. But like I said, we're so new in this. And therefore, I'm asking this question to you again today because this is the 11th day of the lockdown. So is there any change in that, or that remains the same?
So as of now, I haven't come across anything to suggest that pregnant women are more prone or more likely to develop a severe form of disease. This was a serious concern for H1N1 in 2009, where pregnant women were selectively having a more severe version of the disease.
Right.
Doesn't seem to be the case so far. And, you know, based on the fact that we have pretty large numbers, if there was a pattern to emerge that pregnant women were more likely to get infected, I think we would have seen a pattern by now. Doesn't seem to be the case.
Great. So once again, all the pregnant couples out there, just take a deep breath and relax. You know, I keep saying that because I can relate to that. I have a baby who's about 2 years, 9 months old. So, all right. Another question that I want to ask you is that I also spoke with Dr. Reena Dev, who is a veterinarian. She deals in avian as well as exotic animals. And she's,
right.
you know, worked through the world on these things. And with the whole studies that have shown that they started with the wildlife market in Wuhan in China in 2019. And apparently there's also a thing where people said it's coming from bats. So I understand that, you know, from a veterinarian, a lot of people are partial and might say that, oh, okay, you know, people only who are animal lovers might listen to that. But let's hear it from your mouth, that what do you have to say regarding this? Is this a rumor? Is this a truth? It's still under observation or research, that is it transferred from animals, or did it start from a bat or whatever?
So absolutely. I mean, the whole family of coronaviruses are known to be viruses that infect animals. These are called zoonotic viruses, you know, viruses that come from animals. This particular strain of coronavirus has been found in bats in the past. And the current hypothesis is that it moved from bats to humans, possibly through an intermediary. And one of the intermediaries that are being investigated is an animal called the pangolin. Which is eaten a lot in China. It's an exotic animal. It's an exotic scaly animal. The scales are precious. I think it's also eaten for its, it's precious for its meat. And the current hypothesis, and again, it's not completely proven, is that it went from bat to pangolin to humans is one of the theories. But yes, I mean, I think there seems to be a consensus on the fact that it did come from bats.
Okay, but that is about general coronaviruses, right? COVID-19
is... No, I'm talking about COVID-19. No, I'm talking about COVID-19 specifically, yes.
But is it a proven fact, or it's still under research and it's more like in...
Again, you know, I don't know the details in terms of virologically how they prove, they actually prove this thing. But to my knowledge, the virus with the same sequence has been isolated in bats. And they're seeing kind of the same pattern. I also think that there are certain genetic features in a virus that tell us if they actually originate from animals, or they actually, you know, have a part of a DNA of a bird or an animal in it. And I think based on that, there is evidence to suggest that this came from bats.
Okay. But is that any reason for people to abandon their pets? Because a lot of people are so, you know, paranoid about the fact that there's a lot of abandoning of their house pets right now. So do you think that's right, or it has any correlation?
No, I don't think so. This event of even viruses moving from animals to human beings are rare events. You know, if they were that common, we would
Right.
have seen viruses every other day. I mean, lots of people have pets across the world. We
Yes.
are we are we are reasonably intimate with animals in terms of stray dogs, cats, etc. You know, we are
Yeah.
exposed to animals all the time.
Right.
So this is an extremely rare event, and it's almost like some, you know, lots of things have to align and come together for an event like this to happen.
Right.
If you look at coronavirus itself, despite all of them being found in the wild, I mean, we've had this is our third major outbreak. There was SARS, there was
Yeah.
MERS, and now it's COVID-19. So that's
Correct.
three in a span of 20 years, right? So I mean, that gives us an idea of how rare an event this is. And I don't think one needs to be wary of your pets at all,
Right.
because it's not as simple as that. You know, it's not as simple as if you have an animal, that animal's sick, it's going to infect you. You
Right.
know, conditions have to be right. It has to be and most of these viruses which enter the human race for the first time come from wild animals. They don't come from domesticated animals.
Right. All right, guys. So please don't abandon your pets is the bottom line of this.
Absolutely.
It's not the because that will create another problem of its own, you know, where there will be a man-animal conflict that I keep emphasizing on. There will be confused pets on the road that might bite people and whatever might. There's always a consequence to whatever we do, right?
No,
And
I think it's very unfortunate if people are thinking of abandoning their
yeah.
pets right now, because there's absolutely zero reason to do that.
Yes. Doctor, I wanted to ask you, most of my questions are over, but towards the end of it, I wanted to ask you that I recently read of a 37-year-old dying of the virus. And a lot of people say that this is more for people who are old, they really need to be careful. I mean, are you trying to say that because therefore a lot of young people are taking it for granted? You know, that's what I'm trying to say. So, is there a piece of message that you'd like to give out on this?
So absolutely, there are two parts to this, right? Number one, your probability of getting infected, your probability of having a bad outcome in terms of being admitted to an ICU, in terms of dying. So even among young people, incidentally, across the world, the rates of hospitalization are not that low. So people still have disease severe enough to get hospitalized. This figure, which seems to reassure everybody, is the figure of death. So when you look at mortality, people keep saying this over and over again, that if you're under 50, if you're under 60, your probability of dying is less than 1%, or it's 0.1%, it's 1 in 1,000. While that may be true, that doesn't mean that you will not have a disease severe enough that you will need to be hospitalized, that you will need to get oxygen, that may leave scars in your lungs for the rest of your life, that may leave you with lung function that's compromised for the rest of your life. So you may survive, but you may not survive normal for the rest of your life. And I think that's reason enough to, number one, take this seriously. The second reason why young people really should be a little more sensitive about all this is that, fine, okay, you may have a lower risk, but most of us in India live in multi-generational families. Most of us take care of our parents or our grandparents, and you come back home getting infected just with the knowledge that, you know, I am young, it doesn't affect me. But then you come back home and transmit it to someone else who might, and that's very irresponsible, is what I would think. So it's not just ourselves, you know. I mean, a lot of what we are doing right now, social distancing, the lockdown, is to protect the elderly, to protect the most vulnerable in society.
Correct.
And I think we owe it to that. You know, we owe that to our community.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Imagine if our generation of parents are having all this problem, you know, above 50 or 60, as they say, without having gone through a pandemic like COVID-19. Then when we reach their age, and like you said, we might have scars in our lungs or whatever, if at all we are exposed to this virus, then obviously our immunity, our you know, ways of recuperating or convalescing is going to be way lower than them. So if you're not sensitive enough to think of them, then at least think about your own self, is what I feel. But yes, compassion needs to be there in today's time, and I think that is going to be the real savior of everyone. So there is another question that's popping up on my screen. I'm not sure if you'd like to answer this because it talks about the estimate of the number of people who will be infected in India in the next few months. If the percentage of deaths remain low as compared to the rest of the world, what is the reason? I mean,
So
that's something.
a lot of that right now is speculation. A lot of that is based on, you know, lots of different models floating around. Best case scenario, worst case scenario. There is, you know, there are lots of theories floating around that we might be protected to a certain extent because of our BCG vaccination, because we're a tropical country, our humidity is high, etc., etc. But nobody really knows the answer as to in which direction we are heading. We'll know more once testing becomes universally accessible. Once it, you know, once we start testing more and more and more individuals, maybe our numbers will start rising. Based on what we're seeing so far, the numbers are clearly rising. Whether they will rise exponentially like Italy or China or the US, we don't know yet. The second thing is, whether our healthcare system is going to get overwhelmed because of it, that time will tell. So I think these kinds of speculations are guessworks at best.
Yeah.
As we go further and further into the epidemic, these guessworks will start getting more and more accurate because they'll be informed by what we know based on how things are happening, based on, what we see in our clinics. But as of now, I think it's fair to assume a really bad case scenario and therefore, take utmost precaution in whatever way we can.
Yes. And one last question, doctor, is jo hum Hindi mein koshish karenge ki hum baat kare,
bilkul.
That what exactly happens when COVID-19 enters your body? Let's talk about it in a scientific way. Aap Hindi English mein explain kar sakte ho, because a lot of people अब इम्यून हो रहे हैं इस न्यूज़ को, शुरू शुरू में लोग बड़े थे वो कोविड-19 नाउ पीपल आर लाइक ओह व्हाट द हेक, आई एम गोना गो आउट, हो गया नाउ पीपल आर आल्सो कमिंग इन दैट फेज एंड गेटिंग फ्रस्ट्रेटेड एंड जस्ट फाइंडिंग रीजन. सो लेट्स रियली गेट इनटू द फैक्ट्स ऑफ व्हाट हैपेंस एनाटॉमिकली और आई डोंट नो फॉर द लैक ऑफ अ बेटर वर्ड इनसाइड योर बॉडी व्हेन द वायरस स्ट्राइक्स यू. व्हाई इज इट सो डेंजरस?
तो बेसिकली अगर आपको समझो आप इन्फेक्टेड हो, आपके पास आपके शरीर में ये वायरस जी रहा है, आपके लंग्स में जी रहा है, आपके नाक के लाइनिंग में जी रहा है, और जब आप छींकते हो, बात करते हो या खांसी करते हो तो ये फैल जाता है आपके इर्द गिर्द, आपके अराउंड फैल जाता है. अगर कोई इंसान उसके कॉन्टेक्ट में आता है और इन ड्रॉपलेट्स को अगर इनहेल करता है, अंदर ले लेता है, तो वो वायरस जाके जो अंदर की लाइनिंग होती है, हमारे नाक की लाइनिंग होती है, तो हमारे पास बहुत डिफेंस मैकेनिजम्स होते हैं हमारे बॉडी में जो प्रोटेक्ट करते हैं हमको. वायरसेस जाके वो लाइनिंग्स को शेड करते हैं, वो डिफेंस प्रोसेसेस जो होते हैं उनको लो करते हैं. क्योंकि वायरस शरीर में है, आपका बॉडी उसको रिस्पॉन्ड करता है, आपका बॉडी फीवर प्रोड्यूस करता है बिकॉज द वायरस इज इरिटेटिंग योर नोज, आप कभी कभी छींकने लगते हो. आपके एंड दिस इज शुरुआत के स्टेज में इट्स काइंड ऑफ नाक में और गले तक सीमित रहता है. जैसे जैसे ये इन्फेक्शन बढ़ता है, a lot of stuff jo naak mein rehta hai that starts getting sloughed, it starts getting pushed deeper down into the lungs. Aur jab fefdon ke andar, lungs ke andar chale jata hai ye, to isko basically hum pneumonia bolte hain, jo sadharantah bacteria ki wajah se hum pneumonia jhelte hain. Yahan par isko viral pneumonias bolte hain, jahan virus andar jaake baith gaya aapke lungs mein aur aapka lungs uske usko usse ladne ke liye ek reaction produce kar raha hai. And इसका एनालॉजी अगर कोई आपको कहां पर चोट लगती है, तो चोट तो एक टाइम का बात होता है, लेकिन जो सूजन वहां पर आता है, जो दर्द वहां पर होता है, उसको ठीक होने में टाइम लगता है. एंड दैट्स एग्जैक्टली हैपनिंग ऑन द इनसाइड्स ऑफ योर लंग्स. आपके लंग्स के अंदर उस प्रकार का सूजन हो रहा है, आपके लंग्स के अंदर बॉडी बहुत कोशिश कर रही है वहां पर फ्लूइड पोर आउट करने के लिए जो आपको हील करे, लेकिन क्योंकि आपने ये वायरस कभी पहले जिंदगी में देखा नहीं है, तो बॉडी के पास कोई औजार नहीं होते, कोई एंटीबॉडीज नहीं होते हैं ये वायरस को मारने के लिए. इसलिए बॉडी एक रिएक्शन प्रोड्यूस कर रहा है जो ज्यादा इफेक्ट नहीं कर रहा है, बट वो रिएक्शन इटसेल्फ कंट्रीब्यूट कर रहा है जिससे आपको दम लगने लगता है. जब आप सांस लेते हैं, आपके फेफड़ों का काम होता है कि हवा से ऑक्सीजन आपके खून तक पहुंचाना, लेकिन जहां पर वो कॉन्टैक्ट हो रहा है, जहां ऑक्सीजन आपके फेफड़ों से खून तक जा रहा है, अगर वो जगह पे सूजन होगा, अगर वो जगह पे बहुत सारा वायरस बैठा होगा, तो फिर आपको ऑक्सीजन नहीं मिलता है. शरीर को जितना ऑक्सीजन की जरूरत होती है वो फेफड़ा नहीं दे पाता है, तो आपको आपकी सांस फूलती है, आपको दम लगने लगता है. जो इरिटेशन जो अंदर वायरस आपके फेफड़ों को छेड़ रहा है, उससे छूटने के लिए आपका शरीर खांसी करने लगता है, तो थ्रू आउट व्हाटएवर इट कैन. दीज आर ऑल डिफेंस मैकेनिज्म जो हमारे बॉडी में है. इस स्टेज पे समझो ये हो गया 5-6-7 दिन हो गए आपको इन्फेक्शन होके. इस स्टेज पे दो चीजें हो सकती है. एक तो आपका इम्यूनिटी स्ट्रांग इनफ है, आपका शरीर सीख लेता है, समझ लेता है कि ये किस प्रकार का वायरस है, उसके खिलाफ एंटीबॉडीज प्रोड्यूस करता है और आप हील होते हो धीरे धीरे. जैसे जैसे कोई चोट लगती है हमको बॉडी में, वहां घाव भर जाता है और फेफड़े नॉर्मल हो जाते हैं उसके बाद. दूसरा पॉसिबिलिटी ये है कि शरीर का इम्यून रिस्पॉन्स इतना ज्यादा स्ट्रांग होता है किसी कारण से, जो हम टोटली समझ नहीं पाते, कि वो इम्यून रिस्पॉन्स आपको नुकसान पहुंचाता है, आपके दोनों फेफड़ों में पूरा काइंड ऑफ पानी भर जाता है, आप सांस नहीं ले पाते हो, आपको वेंटिलेटर पर डालना पड़ता है, आपको आर्टिफिशियली ब्रीदिंग के लिए आपको सपोर्ट की जरूरत पड़ती है वो टाइम पे. तो ये दो पॉसिबिलिटीज है जनरली. बाय एंड लार्ज इवन अगर आप 80 साल से भी बड़े हो, यू नो 80 साल से बड़े हो, तो 5 में से 4 लोग फिर भी हील होके ठीक हो जाते हैं.
बट
सो इट्स हाई, यू नो आई मीन वी टॉक अबाउट 20% इज अ वेरी हाई नंबर फॉर एनी डिजीज. बट यू नो अ लॉट ऑफ 80-year-olds आउट देयर विल प्रोबेबली बी लिविंग इन मॉर्टल फियर राइट नाउ, अज्यूमिंग दैट यू नो दे आर ऑलमोस्ट 100% गोइंग टू डाई इफ दे गेट द वायरस. दैट्स नॉट द केस. 4 out of 5 विल स्टिल सर्वाइव.
ओके.
And I think that's an important message, you know, that that yeah, I mean, it is very serious,
right?
But there's still a good chance that you will survive.
Right. So basically, the human body has, through its own ways, you know, found its own defense mechanism, whether it's trial and error, whether because it's never dealt with a virus like that, or हमें externally अब तक as doctors या as scientists अभी तक हम इस पे research कर रहे हैं कि ये है क्या. You know, या किस तरीके से हम इसको सॉल्व कर सकते हैं. इन द मीन टाइम एज डॉक्टर्स हम सिर्फ उसके सिम्टम्स रिलीव करते हैं, राइट? लाइक जैसे फीवर हो गया, कॉफ हो गया, या जैसे आपने बोला वेंटिलेटर के थ्रू, तो आप सिम्टम्स को रिलीव करते हो. एंड इन द मीनवाइल बॉडी अब खुद एंटीबॉडीज डेवलप करके, इम्यूनिटी डेवलप करके, इट कम्स आउट ऑफ इट. दैट इज द
ओनली वे. दैट्स एब्सोल्युटली राइट. दैट आई कुडंट हैव सेड इट बेटर. सो एज अ डॉक्टर माय जॉब इज टू सपोर्ट योर बॉडी व्हाइल योर बॉडी हील्स इटसेल्फ. दैट्स ऑल आई एम डूइंग. That's all we do in viral infections, most viral infections.
Right.
All we do is support the body. So give you oxygen, give you ventilation, give you whatever it takes to support your body while the body figures out a way to heal itself.
Right. So you ease the person's you know, life in the moment till he's dealing with it. So guys, today we had an extremely important conversation with Dr. Lancelot Pinto. Thank you, doctor, so much. Is there anything else that you would like to say, or you know, anything else? Although you've covered everything, you've busted myths today, aapne bahut sare insights bhi diye, everything about the virus, about how it must have originated, to the cure, to the vaccines, everything. Aap aur kuch bolna chahte hain logo ko?
Yeah, if I can just take 2 more minutes, you know.
Yes, one of
the things I would really like to request everybody, yes, is to not stigmatize people who are sick, you know. We are seeing a lot of it. I think a lot of people are scared to even get tested nowadays, because they feel if we get tested and we get positive, you know, what will my neighbors think? What will my friends think? You know, I will be ostracized. I think we all need to realize that nobody is special among us. All of us have an equal chance of getting this virus. It could be you tomorrow. It could be me tomorrow. Nobody, absolutely nobody is protected from this virus. Which is why we need to be very nice to people who get, as nice as we can to people who do get infected, because it's not their fault. Most of us are being very sensible about this. Most of us are staying at home. Most of us are, you know, being responsible, despite which, you know, there is a chance that any one of us can get it, you know. So let's stop shaming people who get it. Let's be as supportive as we can. If people need to be quarantined at home, let's be good neighbors and, you know, go and give them food on their drop off food on their doorstep if we can.
Yes.
Let's be supportive rather than get out of them, get out after them, you know. And I think that's one request I would make to everybody out there. Don't stigmatize the disease, you know. Let people come out. Let more people get tested. The more people get tested, the more aware we are of the real problem. The more action can be taken to prevent its spread.
Right.
And the second thing I would just like to reiterate, 3 things extremely important: social distancing, washing your hands, and wearing a mask. You know, if you do these 3 things. I think it'll go a long, long way.
Right. I am so happy that you spoke about shaming. In fact, just a few days back, I had started this campaign called hashtag Corona Shaming, that let's stop Corona Shaming. So far in the society, we've had all kinds of shaming, you know, whether it was mom shaming, fat shaming, skinny shaming. And now there is a new terminology. I don't know if I invented it or whatever, but I realized the fact that people are shaming people who have corona. And therefore, like you rightly said, a lot of people are getting shamed. You know, I mean, it's such a pathetic thing, because I believe that shame is the worst kind of human emotion that a person can feel. It does exactly the opposite of what encouragement should do. People go inside their shells. They don't want to be pointed out, or they don't want to be like, you suddenly like stigmatize the person so heavily that he becomes an outcast. He becomes somebody that doesn't belong to the human race at large. So let's be empathetic and sympathetic towards these people. I'm so glad that you spoke about this as a doctor. And thank you so much, doctor, once again, for your insights एंड आई एम श्योर दैट बहुत लोगों ने बहुत कुछ सीखा होगा, समझा होगा. एंड सबसे बड़ी बात, आपने इतना सारा टाइम दिया, यू आर हियर, यू आर जॉइनिंग मी, दैट इटसेल्फ शोज दैट यू रियली केयर अबाउट दिस सिचुएशन एंड यू वांट दिस मैसेज टू रीच आउट टू एज मेनी पीपल एज पॉसिबल. सो थैंक यू वंस अगेन. Lots of love and lots of power to you. Please be safe, you, your family, your entire team, and I shall hopefully talk to you soon in the future.
Thank you, Nisha. Thanks a lot.
Thanks for joining me. Take care, Doctor. Bye.
You too.
All right, guys. I think that was extremely insightful. आज जो हमने डॉक्टर लैंसलॉट से बात की थी कि है, मुझे लगता है कि ये अर्ली ऑन हमें बात कर लेनी चाहिए थी, बट नंदलेस आज हम 11th डे में हैं एंड लाइक डॉक्टर सेड कि दिस इज अ नॉवल वायरस. नॉवल वायरस का मतलब होता है कि एक ऐसा वायरस जिसके बारे में पहले हमने नहीं कभी सुना या देखा, जो आज से पहले एग्जिस्टेंस में नहीं था. तो इसीलिए साइंस भी इसके ऊपर बहुत रिसर्च कर रहा है तेजी से. इसीलिए अभी तक इसका कोई क्योर नहीं है, इसका कोई वैक्सीन नहीं है. इसके सारे सिम्टम्स से लेकर जब ये वायरस हमारी बॉडी में एंटर होता है तो ये क्या हैवक मचाता है, ये क्या करता है हमारी बॉडी में, ये सब चीजें डॉक्टर ने बताई. कि आप एज डॉक्टर साइंस का फिलहाल इतना ही इतना ही कर पा रहा है कि आपके सिम्टम्स को एज पेशेंट्स आपको रिलीफ दे सके. अगर आपको बुखार है तो शायद आपको बुखार की दवाई दी जाएगी, जॉइंट्स पेन है या लंग्स में आपके पानी भर गया तो वेंटिलेटर पे आपको लगाया जाएगा. लेकिन इस वायरस को अपना टाइम लगेगा. कुछ लोग इस वायरस के लिए एंटीबॉडीज डेवलप करेंगे, इम्यूनिटी डेवलप करेगी उनकी अपनी बॉडी और इस वायरस से बाहर आ जाएंगे. पर प्लीज इसे लाइटली मत लीजिए. सबसे बड़ा हमारा जो डिफेंस मैकेनिज्म है या हमारा जो क्या कहते हैं उसको औजार है इससे फाइट करने का, वो है अवेयरनेस. रूमर्स ना फैलाएं. प्लीज बिना ऑथेंटिकेट किए इंफॉर्मेशन व्हाट्सएप में कैजुअली इस चीज को नहीं भेजें. अगर आपको कोई व्हाट्सएप मैसेज आता है तो पहले पूछिए कि क्या ये आपका अपना एक्सपीरियंस है. और प्लीज लेट्स नॉट बिकम डॉक्टर्स एंड साइंटिस्ट, बिकॉज वी आर ऑन द अदर साइड ऑफ इट. एंड हमें रिस्पॉन्सिबल होना चाहिए कोई भी इंफॉर्मेशन शेयर करने के पहले. स्टॉप कोरोना शेमिंग. प्लीज डॉक्टर लैंसलॉट पिंटो ने भी आज ये बात कही कि अगर हम शेमिंग करेंगे उन लोगों के लिए, उन लोगों से जो कोरोना पॉजिटिव पाए जाएंगे, तो ऐसे लोग शर्म के मारे आगे आके टेस्टिंग भी नहीं करेंगे. बहुत सारे लोग जिनको लगेगा उनके अंदर सिम्टम्स हैं वो टेस्ट भी नहीं करेंगे, जो हमारे चांसेस बढ़ाता है इस वायरस को और ग्रो होने में. तो प्लीज अवेयर होइए इस बारे में एंड प्रिवेंटेटिव मेजर्स लीजिए, यानी कि मास्क पहनना, ग्लव्स पहनना जब आप बाहर जा रहे हैं, हाथ साबुन से धोना. ये बेसिक चीज अब हमको पता है, ये हम बार बार बोली जाती हैं और इसमें कोई रूमर वाली बात नहीं है. आपको पता है कि इन्फॉर्मेशन आपको कहाँ से पानी है. ये ऑथेंटिक हॉस्पिटल्स की वेबसाइट्स, वर्ल्ड हेल्थ ऑर्गेनाइजेशन, हमारे प्रधानमंत्री जी, सब लोगों ने इस बात पे ज़्यादा जोर दिया है. सो लेट्स नॉट टेक इट वेरी लाइटली. एंड मुझे बहुत खुशी है आज की कॉन्वर्सेशन से, बिकॉज इस कॉन्वर्सेशन ने हमें बहुत सारे साइंटिफिक इंसाइट्स दिए. और हाँ, आप लोग मुझसे सवाल पूछते हैं कि क्या ये वीडियो रिकॉर्ड हो सकते हैं, तो डे 3 या डे 4 में मैंने एक फाइनली एक स्क्रीन रिकॉर्डर डाउनलोड किया और मैं ट्राई कर रही थी एंड समबडी हु इज सो स्वीट, उन्होंने देखा कि क्वालिटीज बहुत बुरी है, तो वो लड़की ने डे 1 से सारे वीडियोस रिकॉर्ड किए थे. और एक बार जब ये खत्म हो जाएगा हमारे लाइव चैट्स, बिकॉज अभी आपको पता है कि मेरे ग्रिड में मैं रोज वो पोस्ट करती हूँ ताकि आप लोगों को एक प्रॉपर सिस्टमैटिक तरीके से पता चले कि आज मैं किसके साथ लाइव जाने वाली हूँ. तो जब ये 21 डेज खत्म हो जाएंगे, मैं ये चैट्स दोबारा अपलोड करूंगी एंड आप लोग फिर वो मेरे IGTV वीडियोस में देख सकते हो. सो आई एम रियली हैप्पी कि आज हम डे 11 में ऑफ द #21day लॉकडाउन चैलेंज में आ चुके हैं, जहां मैं आपकी एक्सपर्ट से बात कराती हूं, ऐसे लोगों से बात कराती हूं जो इस समाज में एक डिफरेंस मेक कर रहे हैं. सो आई जस्ट वांट टू टेल यू गाइस दैट थैंक्स फॉर द सपोर्ट, बट प्लीज मैं चाहती हूं कि ये 21 डेज जल्दी खत्म हो और हम विक्टोरियस साबित हों और हम एज अ ह्यूमन रेस इस वायरस पे अपनी जीत पाए. तो अभी तक हमने बात की डॉक्टर कर्सी चावड़ा साइकियाट्रिस्ट, डॉक्टर नौजिया शहरियार गायनेकोलॉजिस्ट, डॉक्टर आशीष जैन ऑर्थोपेडिक सर्जन, डॉक्टर इंदु खोसला पीडियाट्रिक पल्मोनोलॉजिस्ट, डॉक्टर गीता कामत फिजिशियन, डॉक्टर संजय अरोरा फाउंडर ऑफ सबर्बन डायग्नोस्टिक, स्वाति मुखर्जी ट्रस्टी एंड एग्जीक्यूटिव डायरेक्टर ऑफ द वात्सल्य फाउंडेशन, चारुल मलिक सीनियर जर्नलिस्ट इंडिया टीवी, Dr. Reena Dev, veterinarian, Neha Kare Kanabar, founder of Unimo, and Dr. Lancelot Pinto se, jo ek respirologist hai. Ab kal hum ek bahut hi interesting conversation karenge 5 baje yahan par Instagram live par Dr. Jatin Shah se, jo ek IVF expert hai. Bahut sare couples is waqt IVF ke process se go through kar rahe hain ya jinke IVFs planned honge ya phir shayad in between honge us process ke. तो ये भी एक बहुत इंसाइटफुल इंफॉर्मेशन होगी. तो अगर आप इस सिचुएशन से नहीं जा रहे हैं सो मेक श्योर प्लीज ये शेयर कीजिए ताकि ज्यादा से ज्यादा लोगों को पता चले, वो इस लाइव सेशन को ज्वाइन करें और ये इंफॉर्मेशन यहाँ से ले सके. कोई क्वेश्चंस भी होंगे तो आप मुझे भेज सकते हैं. एंड आगे आने वाले दिनों में हम बात करने वाले हैं कुछ फाइनेंस एक्सपर्ट से कि अपनी फाइनेंसिस को इस वक्त हम कैसे कंट्रोल करें या क्या होने वाला है, क्या प्रेडिक्शन है आने वाले दिनों में. चाइल्ड साइकोलॉजिस्ट से, काउंसलर से हम एक दिन आर्ट बेस्ड थेरेपी के बारे में बात करेंगे. एंड यस, और कुछ लोगों से जो बहुत डिफरेंस मेक कर रहे हैं बाय यू नो प्रोवाइडिंग फूड फॉर द पुअर. सो आई होप दैट टुडेज कॉन्वर्सेशन वॉज इंसाइटफुल फॉर ऑल ऑफ यू. थैंक यू फॉर ज्वाइनिंग मी. स्प्रेड द वर्ड, लेट मोर पीपल कम अहेड, वॉच दीज लाइव वीडियोज, बिकॉज यहाँ पर सिर्फ मैं नहीं बात करती हूँ, एक एक्सपर्ट से बात करती हूँ जो इस समाज में एक डिफरेंस मेक कर रहे हैं. सो थैंक यू वंस अगेन फॉर ज्वाइनिंग मी. Stay safe, stay happy, stay healthy, stay under home quarantine, practice self-isolation and social distancing. Stop corona shaming. Happy 21 days to you.